Well, good morning again, everybody, and welcome to Church Without Walls in Hornsey, our Sunday morning time of worship together in isolation. Here we are, Sunday the 10th of May, a few more weeks of lockdown to go, and then who knows, just keep praying for the government as they make decisions about how we're going to move forward. Keep praying for people to be saved and safe during this difficult time, and let's seek God in that. But we've come to set aside some time just to be alone with the Lord together. I'm going to have some time praising him and worshipping him, and try and see this as a time of just rest and reflection as well. We're going to be sharing in communion as well, so if you've got some bread and wine or a substitute, depending on what you've got in your store cupboard and what you can get hold of, I'm sure the Lord understands what it is that you'll be using. And that we're going to be sharing that later. If you haven't got them ready, perhaps you need to pause this video now and just go and get them, and then at the right time in the service I will talk to you next. We'll be taking the bread and the wine together. So before we do that, we're going to have some singing. Let's rise up and sing a very popular song, this one written by Matt Redman, "Bless the Lord, O My Soul."
You guys take it.
Bless the Lord, O my soul. Worship his holy name.
Beautiful.
And sing like never before.
Oh, my soul.
I worship your holy name. Jesus, your name. When the sun comes up, it's a new day dawn. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before, let me be saved when the evening comes.
Even though the sun goes down in Times Square tonight, let's sing.
Bless the Lord. His holy name, sing like never before. Oh, my soul, I worship your holy name. You're rich in love and you're slow.
Praise unending, yeah.
10,000 years, it's gonna be forevermore. Oh, Jesus, on that day when my strength is failing, oh, yeah, the end draws near, and my time has come. Jesus, still my soul will sing your praise.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Oh.
pray. Father God, we draw close to your throne in the name of Jesus. We enter your holy presence because we are washed clean with the blood of the Lamb, our Saviour who was crucified for us. Grant us, Lord, a fresh insight into the price that you paid to save us this morning. Bless us with a vision of the depth of your love for us as we worship you. In Jesus' name, amen. Know that God is with you where you are. Where you are, in your home, God is with you. And we're all joined together. Although we can't physically be together, we're all joined together in Jesus. It's his family. We're brought into his family, into his body, connected together into the body of Christ. And we're made, the word of God tells us, we're made into a holy temple, that each part of us, we're all different stones brought together to be a building, a physical building in which God dwells, is present by his Holy Spirit. The Spirit of God dwells inside of you. God is with you where you are. That's why we call him Emmanuel. God is with us. And that's only possible because of what Jesus has done for us. Normally, a holy God would not be able to come near us because of our sin, but because of what Jesus has done, then he can come and dwell with us. He's restored this relationship, brought us back to himself, because Jesus laid aside everything, all his majesty, and allowed himself to be crucified, a shameful death. I've been reading a book at the moment about the crucifixion and the significance to us as believers. And sometimes, perhaps even in modern church, we're sort of losing sight of that a little bit, and we're in danger of glossing over it. But the crucifixion is so important to us. Some people see a crucifix or a cross as a religious sign, and yet that's quite an anomaly, really, because it's such an irreligious act. Human beings with sinful hands taking hold of their Creator and killing him in such humiliating circumstances, and the Lord allowing himself to be taken in that way, for one. So why did he do that? Well, in Luke chapter 19 and verse 10, Jesus says this. He says, "The Son of Man came to look for and to save people who are lost." What's happened in that chapter, that's verse 10 of verse 19, at the beginning of that chapter, Luke chapter 19, Jesus is on his way to Jerusalem and he comes to a place called Jericho. And as he's going through that town there, there's a man called Zacchaeus. And Zacchaeus, if you went to Sunday school, would you know, was a very little man. But the important thing about Zacchaeus was he was a tax collector. He was unclean. He was unrighteous. The people looked down on him, not just because he was small, but because he was unclean. Why was he unclean? Well, he would collect taxes from Jews to pay to the Romans. And they had to pay their taxes with Roman coins. And on the side of a Roman coin was a graven image which declared Caesar to be God. So to have a graven image of a God was breaking the commandments. And so the Jews wouldn't want to handle this dirty money. But that's what the Romans insisted on being paid in. And so because Zacchaeus, a Jew, sided with the Romans and got this job of collecting taxes from them, handling this dirty money, as they would call it, then he was considered to be unclean, spiritually unclean. No hope for him. And so the people despised him. And yet Jesus came looking for Zacchaeus. And he found him and he rescued him. And he turned his life around and brought righteousness to this unrighteous man. And Jesus says at the end of that incident, verse 10, he says, "The Son of Man came to look for and to save people who are lost." You go back a few chapters before that, in chapter 15 of Luke, you find again Jesus is sat down with tax collectors and sinners. And the Pharisees, the righteous people, the self-righteous people, those who had these strong disciplines and trying to keep the commandments and were so proud of the way that they did what they could and lived this high level of spiritual discipline, they looked down and they criticized Jesus for mixing with the wrong sort. Tax collectors and sinners, because they were the spiritual elite, the Pharisees. There was a trend forming in religion, and it continues to this day, but it was emerging around about the time that Jesus physically walked this earth. And it's a thing called Gnosticism. It's about knowledge. It's about becoming spiritually elite. There's a danger of that in the church even today. This idea that you can reach a higher level of spirituality than others, and that it's all about the effort that we put in to reach God, that we need to deepen knowledge and become more disciplined, and to the point where we can look down on other people and think, well, they're not as spiritual as me. Well, they don't go to church as often as I, but who goes to church these days? They don't spend as much time reading the Bible as I do. They don't get up as early as I do to pray for people. And we can be in danger of becoming proud of our spiritual accomplishments. And to the extent where other people think, what's the point? I will never reach that. I can never be that good. I can never do that. And they give up. Jesus said he came looking for the lost, for the helpless, for the hopeless, those who had no hope. That's at the beginning of Luke chapter 15. And in Luke chapter 15, he tells three stories, three parables. And the first one is about the lost sheep. It goes like this. That's a picture on Facebook with words on it. I couldn't find it to put it in this video, but it's about the lost sheep, and it says this, that it doesn't make sense to leave 99 sheep alone and go looking for one, unless you're the one that's lost. Jesus told that story. The second story he told was about a woman who had 10 special coins, and she lost one of them, and she turned the house over. She looked everywhere until she could find that coin. And then she too rejoiced over this discovery, something that was a treasure to her that she'd lost, and that she found it again. And the third story Jesus tells is about a man who has two sons, and one of them, the younger son, he says to his dad, I can't wait for you to die. I can't wait for my inheritance. I want my money now. Give it to me now. That's quite an insult to his father. But the father gives him the money that he would inherit once the father had died. And this young son goes off. He leaves the family behind. He goes to a distant land. He goes away from the promises and all that was dear to him. And he goes and lives a terrible life there. And he squanders this money. His people flock around him and help him spend it. There's those people willing to help you spend money. And they come and they help him spend that money. And he wastes it all in sinful living. And then a famine comes and all the money runs out, his friends disappear, and he ends up having to look after pigs. And he's so hungry, he even wants to eat the pig swill, the food that the pigs have got. And he thinks, do you know what? I'm stupid. Comes to his senses. He says, I'm stupid. I should have stayed with my father. Even there, even my father's servants are treated better than this. So he decides he's going to go home. He's going to apologize. He says, look, Dad, I don't expect any special privileges. Let me just please be one of your servants, because I know I've done wrong. And he sets off to go back home. And as he's going home, his father is looking out for him. And as he appears in the distance, the father goes running towards him. And he tries to get out this apology that he's been practicing and rehearsing and to repent. But the father throws his arms around him. And despite the smell of the pigs and all that must be clinging to the rags that he's wearing, he kisses him and he hugs him. And he's delighted because the son that he lost is found again. Do you know that those stories, they're not about a sheep that's lost. It's about a shepherd that goes looking. It's not about a coin that gets lost. It's about a woman who searches until she finds the treasure that she'd lost. It's not really about a son who's a bit of a prodigal. It's about a father who can't help loving and is delighted to get his son back. It says in verse 20, it says, the youngest son got up and started back to his father. And when he was still a long way off, his father saw him and felt sorry for him. He ran to his son and hugged and kissed him. What an image that is. You know, that would have been quite shocking for Jesus' original listeners, those that heard this as Jesus was telling this story, those Pharisees, those religious people, those spiritual elite, to hear that story, because that son behaved outrageously, did not deserve anything. But the father loves outrageously and runs in an undignified way. It would be unseemly for a patriarch of a family in the Middle East in those days to be seen running. They've got to be ordered and controlled. And yet the image that Jesus presents in this story is this father running and perhaps his, having to lift his robes up and they'd see his ankles and maybe even his bony knees as he's charging along to meet his son. You know, as I read the Word of God, I discover a God who religiously pursues the lost. Right back in the beginning, when everything goes wrong, that account that we're given in Genesis 3 and humans have turned their back on God, they've decided they want to do things their own way. And the image is given of a garden and the humans are in this garden, living in paradise, living in this perfect relationship with God. And it says that in verse 8 of Genesis chapter 3, it says that God comes into the garden looking for them. And the humans are afraid. Adam and Eve are afraid and they hide themselves. And they can hear God moving. They hear the wind moving and God, the Spirit of God moving through that place. And they're hiding. And it says in verse 9, the Lord called out to the man and asked, "Where are you?" You know, as I read that account, I think the sense of loss is on God's behalf more than humans. God is sad at what he has lost because that relationship, that perfect relationship he had with human beings is broken because sin has come in. We've disobeyed, we've turned our backs, we wanted to be our own God. And God senses that loss. And that's why salvation's plan came into being. Salvation's plan. We used to sing an old chorus when I were a lad. We used to sing, "Oh, the love that drew salvation's plan. Oh, the grace that brought it down to man. Oh, the mighty gulf that God did span at Calvary." And it would go on a little bit like that. But that salvation plan, God has planned. He's brought everything into being. His work to restore that relationship. And I believe that God still comes looking rigorously, pursuing you and me in his love for us. I've shared with some of you before an account of a dog we used to have, Grace. And you know in the old days, you know, like in 2019, when you could go to the beach and go for a paddle in the sea, and you get a stretch of sand and you take your shoes and socks off and you go walk across the sand, but invariably there'd be a bit that was a bit stony. So you're walking quite happily along the sand and then you get to the stones and then they'd be uncomfortable to walk on. So you'd be treading carefully and it disrupts your walk. And then you get to the sand again and you can walk normally and get into the sea and fringe your toes off and run back again. But we used to take Grace down to the beach and she loved chasing a ball. as you're walking along the beach, she was quite happy on the sand, but you get to the stones and she would do the same thing. She would walk carefully over the stones because they were uncomfortable to walk on. But then we'd get the ball out and we'd throw the ball and she'd go charging down the beach on the sand, charging across to get this ball. And if the ball went across the stones, she'd charge across the stones, paid no heed to them because all her focus was on getting that ball. Obsessed with it, rigorously pursuing the ball. Nothing was going to get in her way. Nothing was going to slow her down. Nothing was going to stop her. That's how God approaches you and I. In his love for us, he rigorously pursues us. Aren't you glad that the Lord loves you so much? You know, this is one of the unique things about the Christian faith. All other faiths are about trying to find God through learning or discipline or sacrifice, or trying to become God, trying to reach, trying to transcend to a higher plane, to be lifted out of the physical into the spiritual world through meditation and hardship and all sorts of practices and so on. And all other world religions and faith systems are about trying to find God, trying to get to God. All human effort to save yourself. But Christian faith is different because from what the Bible teaches, it's God who comes looking for you and me. Not because we deserve it, but because he loves us.
Blessed.
blessed Redeemer, Emmanuel.
Going to share communion now. I'm just going to remember what the Lord has done for us. I'm taking the words from Luke 22 from the Last Supper, where Jesus instigated this feast for his followers. It says he took the cup in his hands and he gave thanks to God, and then he told the apostles, take this wine and share it with each other. I tell you that I will not drink any more wine until God's kingdom comes. If you've got your bread, get it ready. Verse 19 says, Jesus took some bread in his hands, he gave thanks for it, and he broke it. He gave it to his disciples, to his followers. He said, this is my body, which is given for you. Eat this as a way of remembering me. So take your bread, break it, eat it, consume it. Think about what the Lord has done for you. It says that after that Passover meal, he took another cup of wine in his hands, and Jesus said, this is my blood. It is poured out for you. And with it, God makes his new agreement, his new covenant, his New Testament, the blood of Jesus shed for you. So take the cup, take that drink, think of the price that has been paid so that you and I can be restored to this perfect relationship with the Holy God. Lord God, thank you for loving us so much. Thank you for seeking us and finding us. Thank you for laying aside your majesty, stepping out of your glory and submitting to a shameful death, bearing all our sin and shame. We have taken this bread and wine as you've commanded, declaring that it is in your death and resurrection that we are saved. We have no other hope. Thank you, Lord God, for saving me.
Thank you for saving me. What can I say? You are my everything. I will sing your praise. You shed your blood for me. What can I say? You took my sin and shame, a sinner called by name. Great is the Lord. Great is the Lord. For we know your truth has set us free.
forgiven is my sin. Jesus, my only hope, the Savior of the world. Great is the Lord, we cry, God, let your kingdom come. Your word has led me see, thank you for saving me.
By this time that we've had together, I hope you've felt the Lord's presence with you. I hope you've had some insight into how much he loves you. Over this coming week, just think about all God has done to get close to you. Allow him in. Allow him to surround you with his love, to uplift you with his hands. Be aware, try to be aware of his presence in all things. He rigorously pursues you because he loves you too much to let you go. I'm going to finish with a song. I've finished now, but there's one song that's been shared on social media. I know many of you have seen it. This is a blessing for the UK, and I trust that it will bless you. Look forward to being able to share something with you again next week. Until then, please stay safe and stay close to the Lord. Keep praying for each other and allow God to bless you. Use this time of isolation to get close to God. Use this, think of it not as being cut off, but as being set aside to be with God. Use the time wisely. I think the church is being prepared. You know, like those caterpillars that turn into a chrysalis and then they sort of seem dormant for a while. They emerge as a butterfly. See a lot of butterflies in the garden at the moment. I really believe that the church is good. If we get right with God, we can emerge from this time of being set aside. That dormancy of the chrysalis, of the caterpillar turning into the chrysalis, that dormancy, while it's there, it looks like nothing's happening. That's where the changes are taking place and that transformation is going on. So when we emerge, let's fly for the Lord and glorify him. Until then, we're still the church. We're still his people. He's still with us. He's still working. Keep growing in your faith and knowledge of him and be blessed in Jesus' name. Amen.
Face toward you. shine upon you
and be gracious to you.
The Lord turn his face toward you
and give you peace.
From heaven, this isn't second guessing. We know that we are protected. May the peace that surpasses all understanding be our message. Grace and favors in your nature, in your essence.
May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations,
and your family, and your children,
and the children, and the children. May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations, and your family, and your children, and their children, and their children. May his favor be upon you and a thousand.